welcome to the planning committee. My name is Councillor Anita Leach, I'm the chair of the committee. My role this evening is to ensure that the committee runs smoothly, having regard to procedure, behaviour and ethics. To explain who the rest of the people on the tables here tonight are, to my immediate right is the council solicitor, who will give advice to the committee on the procedural or legal matters that might arise. To my left are the council's planning officers, highway engineer and environmental health officer, who will present the applications this evening and give any technical advice to the committee that might be sought. The rest of the people you see down both sides of the tables are the elected members who will consider the applications this evening and make the decisions. Before each application is considered, there will be a short presentation by the planning officers. In the event that an application has received a qualified petition signed by 25 signatures or more, one representative of the petition will be invited to address the committee in support of the petition for up to 5 minutes, and I will be strict about the 5 minutes. If a petitioner addresses the committee, then the applicant or their agent will be invited to make representations to the committee in support of their application, again for up to 5 minutes. However, if a petitioner has not addressed the committee, then the applicant or their agent will not be invited to make any representations. A ward councillor can address the committee in relation to an application. The ward councillor may speak on behalf of the residents. However, once the ward councillor has returned to the public gathering, they may not return to take part in any debate that may follow within the committee. The application will then be open to debate and discussion by members of the planning committee, who will then make the decision on the application. I am going to adjust the order of tonight's agenda with the permission of the committee, as we do have a lot of people here for agenda items 7 and 10. So if the committee are happy for that to happen.
Yes,
thank you. If a site visit is requested and approved by the committee this evening, this matter will not be discussed. Will be discussed as a subsequent planning meeting. Committee, can I have approval for the minutes on pages 1 to 10, please?
Yes,
ma'am. Are there any declarations of interest? Any requests for site visits? Moving swiftly on then. Okay, so as I said, we'll go to agenda item 7, then 10, then we'll move out to order. Okay, so agenda item 7 is 4 Mill Lane, Greensby. Can we have a presentation, please?
Thank you, Chair. This application is for the only property before Mill Lane, which is an only terrace property. There are a couple of elements to the proposal. The first is to remove the front garden wall and hard surface the front garden area to create a parking area, which is similar to other properties along that particular terrace. The second is raised to the back of the property. There's an existing two-storey and single-storey outbuilding at the moment. The proposal is to demolish these and to create a two-storey extension at the rear of the property. It's probably clearer if I can show you some plans that will illustrate what's there now and what's proposed. So, at the moment, on the left of the screen, you have the existing situation. Top is ground floor, bottom is first floor, and then on the right-hand side of the screen is the proposals. So at the minute you have an extension. This is the neighbouring property here, and this is the application site below it. So that's the boundary line. So at the moment, you have a first floor outrigger, and a single-storey extension that runs along the back. So this is single-storey, and this is first floor here. We which is replicated on the property and along the terrace. So the proposal is to take that down and put a larger single-storey extension, which goes up to a two-storey extension. At the minute, the existing single-storey extension, the projection of it is to 4.6 metres from the property. The two-storey element of it projects 2.9 metres from the back of the property. So the proposal is to take it down and put a two-storey extension, which would then project 4.9 metres from the back of the property. So that's an extra 30 centimetres on the single-storey extension and another 2 metres on the upper-storey extension. Because we're concerned about the window in the adjoining property, the bedroom window, which is here, however, it's got a fairly restricted outlook because of the two-storey outlook that's there. The proposals have been amended to step back in the new extension so that it still retains the same aspect, 45 degree aspect from the bedroom window. So in terms of the scale of the extension, we feel it's in keeping with the proposal, with the property and the scale of the property. There are other extensions to the ground floor and further along the terrace, there's another two-storey extension, which is not dissimilar to this. So we feel the changes retain the amenity of the adjacent property. There is a property number two, which is to the north of the application site. Which is to the north. As you can see, it's a fairly unusual property in that it has windows on all elevations, so it faces the side of number four already. It has windows. It also has windows on the back, on the side facing the lane, and on the other side. It has a single story projection of the sort of the L shape, which faces number four, and has a habitable room window on the very end of that elevation. When looking at the impact of the proposals on this particular property, we were concerned initially that there might be a greater degree of overshadowing and loss of amenity to that property. However, we felt that as it's more sort of a side-to-side relationship as well as a traditional rear to side relationship, we'd have to assess it on that basis. So the windows that are on the existing property, number two, are already facing the side of number four. The extension which projects out the back will have some impact on the ground floor window, which is at the back of number two. This property has a long rear garden, west-facing garden, a lot of light to the existing conservatory, and the window that's on the end of the small outbreak facing them before is really, it's one that we've treated as a side window as we would to another property. So on that basis, we're happy that the proposed extension wouldn't have an unreasonable effect on the ability of that property and on number six, and it is recommended.
Thank you, Sheila. What I did mention at the start here is that agenda item 9, which is 277 Telegraph Road, has been withdrawn this evening. So if there is anybody here for that application, I'm sorry, I didn't tell you straight away, but we won't be discussing that this evening. Okay, is there a board council that would like to speak on the Mill Lane application? Would you like to come forward? If I could just ask you to state your name for the record, please.
Thank you, Chair. I'm Councillor Wendy Clements from Greensville Primary and Early Ward. I'd like to thank members for the site visit yesterday, and I think it was apparent from the moment that the minibus turned up and parked on double yellow lines on the junction that there are challenges for traffic at this location. And that's why there's been no objection to the proposed off-street parking area. Even though if the application receives consent, there is concern about how construction traffic would actually be accommodated. The members who were able to be there saw for themselves that this is a terrace of five properties, which actually date back to around 1895. They're amongst the oldest dwelling properties in houses in the historic village of Greensville, and they're unique in their design and character. They're much photographed, they're even painted by people, because of their historical interest. The proposition that residents have asked me to put is that the scale of the two-storey rear outrigger is detrimental to the residential amenity of the neighbours and the visual aspect of the development as experienced by them and the wider community. One of the residents wrote in his submission, "The proposed development is so significant, overbearing and out of scale, that it would, in my opinion, permanently alter the character of this unique development." Arising from what you saw on the site visit, I'd like to highlight the impact, the increasing impact on neighbouring properties, which comes from extending the out a further 30 centimetres and being two stories throughout. It is welcome there's been a slight amendment to the second story in consideration to property number six. But in truth, if you were living there, or if it was your living room, which was becoming even more recessed and pine filling, we wouldn't be finding it very pleasant. Members, the property at number two, the dining room, which comes out to the side, is an original feature of the home, and it's not just the conservatory, which is 3.7 metres away from number two, from number four. So you saw for yourself as well, when you came, the difficult nature of access to the rear of these properties, which does include walking on a narrow right-of-way through a tunnel, so to speak, and then along behind each of their properties to reach the number four at the end. So one comment from a resident, access to the rear of the five cottages is through an alleyway of 3 foot 3 inches wide. All building materials, scaffolding, etc. would have to come through through the alleyway and through two more gardens. There's concern about health and safety, continual flow of builders, and danger for the other residents. Should it be that members are minded to approve the application? I know that residents have asked if you would consider asking the applicant to indemnify the owners of the adjoining properties on that alleyway, so that they don't bear any cost of repairs of the passageway or increased premiums in the event of damage. However, I'd ask you to refuse this application, and for me it is around HS 11 and that the proposal for the extension is not appropriate to the size of the plot, dominates the existing building and is so extensive as to be unneighbourly, with particular regard being had to the effect on light to and the outlook from neighbours' habitable rooms. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Can I open the subject committee? David?
Yes, thank you, Chair. This site visit took place on Tuesday, of course, not yesterday, but it was a very worthwhile visit in that it clearly demonstrated the way this area has developed over the years and almost become the house that Jack built. In fact, all of them seem to show evidence of being the house that Jack built. Having looked at it in detail, my concern is not so much with number two, that I believe has sufficient amenity space, garden space, and space around it to not be too adversely affected by what is being proposed. My main concern is the fact that the house next door, which of course is number six, if I recall it correctly, already has limited light and access from the rear to their ground floor rear room, which it would be, I imagine, by the fact that the buildings already take a lot of that light away. My belief is that if this extension was to be built, it would create something similar to being about 40 yards in the Mersey Tunnel and coming out of the Mersey Tunnel. In other words, the view for that resident in number six would be virtually tunnel vision down to their garden, because the whole thing to me smacks of overdevelopment of that particular site to the extent that it would be an unneighbourly development for the neighbour at number six and possibly the neighbours in general on the whole of that terrace to accept a dramatic loss of amenity value. So I'd like to hear what other people say, perhaps some of those who also went on the site visit, but I have got a reason for refusal that I would like to put to committee at the appropriate time. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, David. Steve?
Yeah, I'd be interested to questions of an officer. You referred to other extensions on that road. what sort of in comparison are they of similar size to the proposal in the application?
Through you, Chair. Most just have the same two-storey and single-storey outrigger as the property has at the moment. The property towards the very end of the terrace, which is just off the, does have a larger extension, which is similar to the ones proposed today. I did go on the site visit myself, and I think I would describe these postures as quite unique. I've never experienced somebody having to go along the back of a row of houses to actually get to their own home. I would imagine that there would be difficulties in terms of the development of these properties, this property. And you know that I'm not sure sort of like how the development would take place, but that is not a planning consideration, and that's the comment that really I'd like to make. So if there aren't any other comments, David, you said you'd like to move refusal.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. Just one other very brief comment on the late list. It does refer to the fact that you could just turn it up the late list petition to. The bottom line on the first page says overall it is not considered that the proposal would have a significant greater impact on neighbouring properties than exists at present. Well, that of course is a matter of opinion that I don't have to agree with. I think this proposal would exacerbate and make worse what is already there. So my reason for refusal, which I would like to lodge with you, is the following. The proposed extension, by reason of its siting and projection, would have an overbearing effect on the adjoining property, 6 Mill Lane. This would be detrimental to the amenity of this property and neighbours, contrary to Unitary Development Plan Policy HS. I move that as a reason for refusal, and I'm obviously looking for a seconder.
Okay, so Councillor
Elston
moved that, and Councillor
Lutie
is seconding that. All those in favour of refusals? All those against? Okay, so that's lost. The officer's recommendation is to approve subject to conditions listed and the conditions on the late list. Do you have a mover? Denise, I've got you to move, Steve as a seconder. All those in favour? Those against? Okay, that's carried.
If we can
now move to agenda item 10, which is pages 61 to 68 in the packs, we have a presentation for you.
Thank you, Chair. This is an application for a building in Sogn Massey. The history of the site is relevant because there have been several applications for the programme. So in 2015, we gave permission for two buildings to be reconstructed in the green belt, slightly larger size. That was approved. The works that went ahead ended up with a larger structure than was actually approved. An application was submitted to regularise that, and we refused it because we felt the structures were there were just too big and a lot from what was originally approved. This went to appeal, we sent enforcement notices, this went to appeal, and the inspector upheld the enforcement notice and agreed that the buildings were inappropriate development, they were out of character, dwelling posts in the green belt. So what's before you now is an attempt to go back to the original consent, so to reduce the scale of the building. Which would mean taking the bridge down by a metre, taking the eaves down by just under a metre, and taking out windows and features that made it look like a house in the first place. So it's more like the original approval. The reason it needs another approval is because it's 50 centimetres wider in one dimension. So it's got a slightly larger floor area of just under the original approval. We feel that that in itself is not material in terms of how we assess this application. It's same height, same bulk as the building that's originally approved in 2015. And we feel on that basis that it should be recommended for approval, subject to conditions for the work to be carried out in a specific time period. There is a petition.
Okay, we do have a petition. This is a lead petitioner here to speak on this.
Yes.
If I could ask you to say your name and address for the record, please.
My name is Leslie Spence and I'm the chairman of the Stoke Massey Conservation Group. The petition has asked the committee to take note of the history of this application. This application is an attempt to avoid the consequences of the current planning enforcement notice, which is supported by the National Planning Inspectorate. The building in question replaces derelict stables that stood on the land that the applicant purchased in 2014. The land is in green belt. In December 2014, the applicant made a pre-planning application to convert the stables to a habitable property. He was advised by planning officers that such an application would likely be refused. In early 2015, the applicant told the then owner of the adjacent property that he was determined to gain planning approval for a domestic residence. He confirmed that he had been successful in similar circumstances in Mells, and he warned the resident in question not to stand in his way, or he'd make life difficult for them, and might even allow travellers to use the land. A statement from that resident is available if required. The applicant can only access the site via his neighbour's private lane, and the lane has speed bumps fitted prior to the applicant buying his property. Without authorisation, the applicant ripped up the speed bumps and was given a criminal damage caution by the police. The neighbour had to bear the cost of reinstating the speed bumps. The neighbouring property that owns the lane was sold in the first half of 2015. As soon as the new owners moved in, the applicant again and without permission ripped up the speed bumps so as to facilitate better access to his contracting vehicles. In June 2015, the applicant applied for and was granted planning permission exclusively for equestrian use. And it's important to note that he was granted the exact height, width and depth dimensions he asked for. Similarly, he was granted the window and door configurations he asked for. The building in question was to be a simple hay and machinery store. Work commenced and the applicant instructed his builders. In a flagrant, deliberate breach of his planning consent, he exceeded the roof height by 39 inches and the depth of the floor plan by 20.5 inches. He also repositioned the doors and the gable ends rather than front facing and fitted architectural windows in the gable eaves and a rear facing window. None of this was authorised in his original planning consent. You might have noticed that this so-called machinery and hay store has no less than six expensive double glazed Velux type windows, quality brickwork, domestic grade insulation and a fine slate roof, unlike the tin roof breeze block construction of the adjacent stable block. It seems that machinery and hay require much more care than horses. Does a hay store really need nine double glazed windows and three doors? We think not. The planning department were alerted by local residents that what was being built bore no resemblance to the original planning consent. In August 2016, the applicant attempted to legitimise his flagrant breaches by asking for retrospective approval. This was refused and the applicant appealed to the National Planning Inspectorate to upheld the council's earlier refusal. There are no construction errors here to be borne in mind. This application is part of a long game, a deceitful plan to gain change of use by stealth. Having consistently acted unreasonably and treated the planning process with contempt, the applicant now asks this committee to be reasonable with him and grant concessions. He offers to reduce the roof height and reconfigure the door and window openings, but offers no remedy to the fact that he's stolen an extra 7 square yards of floor space by exceeding the plot depth by 2.5 inches. It's no accident that the footprint proportions are now more appropriate for a domestic building. Local residents conduct their planning applications within the spirit and legal requirements of planning law. This applicant must do no less. But this developer is not a man who abides by the rules. He should not be allowed to gain advantage by subverting the planning process. In June 2015, he got exactly the planning consent he asked for. He should build exactly to that consent, and this application should be refused.
Can I just tell you how long it is?
Any costs incurred by the applicant are entirely his own fault. He gambled upon breaching his planning consent and getting away with it. He presumed the planning inspector would roll over, but he didn't. He's been contemptuous with this council's planning process and very deliberately ignored his planning consents. The law-abiding citizens of Sogol Massey expect all residents to comply with the planning law, and we will be disappointed if this committee allows this applicant to gain any unwarranted advantage.
Thank you for sticking to time.
Thank you.
Would the applicant or agent like to come forward? No, no. Mr. O'Bell, council would like to speak on this. If I could just ask you to state your name.
Yeah, sure. My name is Councillor Bruce Bowery, representing North West and Sogol Massey Board. Thank you, Chair. I'd like to start off by thanking the committee for granting the site visit last Tuesday, which was, I think, was very much way acquired. The applicant was quite open and up front 3 years ago when he told residents of his long-term plan to use these buildings as dwellings once he had exploited the planning rules. While I realise that while that could be construed as rumour or innuendo and it's not a consideration in planning law, I believe that by following the process used by the applicant, we can demonstrate the shocking breach of the planning permission that the applicant applied for, was granted and chose to ignore. Committee members may also be interested to note in the planning agenda for tonight's meeting, amongst historical planning applications for this site, is a pre-planning application from Mr. Cliff Upton, the applicant, dated December 2014, seeking the refurbishment and repair of existing farm buildings and or conversion to form habitable dwellings. Be under no illusion that this was the aim then and is still the long term. As far as the building is concerned, you only have to look at the building in question to realise it is a dwelling. It may not be used as a dwelling for some time until further manipulation of the planning rules and regulations have been taking place to require change of use. The build quality and the standard of materials are far superior for equestrian use. The planning applications for this development have been ongoing for 3 years. If the applicant would have built according to the planning permission that he was granted back in September 2015, both the stable and the barn storage would have been finished long ago. Residents watched with interest as the building progressed and were not surprised at all when building B was considerably taller and wider than planning had approved. When the planning department checked the building to drawing and condemned it for being disproportionately large in comparison to the original permission granted, it is fair to say that nobody was surprised by the blatant disrespect of the planning permission that had been granted. Below is a list of the deviations from the original granted planning permission. The building is now half a metre wider than was given planning permission for. It's a full metre higher than planning permission was granted. The front elevation was minus a stable door and a single door. That was replaced by three double windows instead of two. The rear elevation had gained an extra window in the centre. One side elevation had lost a single door and gained a double door. Both side elevations had gained a porthole window. In total, some considerable deviation from the original planning permission granted. We now see the real motive when a second planning application is submitted in August 2016, asking for the as-built design to be granted planning permission. David Paul wrote to the applicant with a notice of refusal of planning permission. And I quote from that letter.
Thank you.
They would need.
You have to use a tenner.
It's open to take.
There we go. The proposed building is disproportionately large in comparison to the original building, which replaces and constitutes inappropriate development. This results in an obtrusive structure which is out of character with the surrounding area and rural nature of the site, and has an adverse impact on the openness of the green belt. The proposal is therefore contrary to the National Planning Policy Framework, paragraph 89, and policy GB2 for the Wirral Unitary Development Plan. Not content to accept this decision, the applicant appealed to the planning inspectorate, who visited the site and upheld the decision by the Wirral Council. The applicant was told he could either comply with the original planning application or demolish the building. Here is an extract from the planning inspectorate's appeal decision. It is suggested that the enforcement notice could be amended to require the development to comply with the terms of the permission reference the application. The council disputes this, pointing out that given the unauthorised increase in the footprints, height of eaves and height of the ridge of the building, it could not be easily amended to comply with the permission. I would agree, it is not obvious to me, and specific information has not been given to explain how, in practical terms, this could be achieved without very extensive demolition work. While the latest planning application proposes to reduce the roof height by 1 metre to conform to original planning consent, there is no intention to reduce the footprint, which is 7 square metres larger. To the building looking more like a house than a barn storage. And as stated earlier in the notice of refusal of planning permission from the day before, we are still of the opinion the proposed building is disproportionately large in comparison to the original buildings. I'm disappointed that the planning case officer has recommended approval for this application. I'm also disappointed with the wording of the application. It says alterations to reduce the size of existing newly constructed barn following the planning appeal. The application would be more suitably worded. It asked for planning permission for the additional 7 square metres that were also added illegally. If the committee do approve this planning application tonight, I am convinced that the applicant will be back with further applications, suggesting that having to reduce the height of the building is deemed excessive and that other options could be considered. If approved, it would send a clear message to the people of Wirral that residents can apply for planning permission and exploit the rules to obtain permission for a planning application that previously would have been unacceptable. Members of the Planning Committee, in summary, I request that you refuse this planning application for the reasons previously quoted, and that the applicant is instructed to comply with the planning permission that he applied for and was granted. We are still of the opinion that the notice of refusal of planning permission from David Ball and the planning inspector is still relevant. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Can
I
open
the committee, please?
Right. I think the salutary lesson that we have to learn is we can't make a judgments on the character or nature of the applicant as a reason for refusal. So as much as we may have had a game played, if, and I've said this in the past, if old Nick himself, the devil himself, was the applicant, we would have to consider it equally as if it was anyone else. So we have to, we just have to deal with that, and that's the case. This committee gave more or less the as I understand, an approval for the application. And the difference is this half metre in width, I think. But by the thing Bruce was saying is that the thing that is more difficult to achieve for the applicant would be the lowering of the height, the eaves and so on. I think we have been boxed into a corner as a committee and effectively have to give approval. I just want to possibly, if the officer can map out, if we were to give refusal, what would be the next stage and where what's the sort of timeline or what would that lead to? Because this seems to me, if we approve this and we insist that this is adhered to, then we get action quicker rather than longer. I just need to sort of have in your mind what the consequences of refusal may be further down the line. Does that make sense to committee members?
Thanks, Steve.
Chair, there is still a law enforcement notice on this site, so if this application were refused, we could continue with the enforcement notice on the site. We'll make a recommendation for this application. What I took into consideration was, would this have been approved in the first place? So would a building with that extra footprint have been approved in the first place? That's the kind of assessment we made with this application too.
Looking at the dimensions of the original approved application, was 66.566 square metres, the refused one was 73.911, and the current proposal is 72.95, less than a square metre from what was refused. What I'm concerned about is basically, what was the reason to allow the larger footprint than the original one in the application? Why don't we just say, sorry, this is the application that's approved, whatever it takes to do it, you put it back to that. It seems to me on the face of it that we've allowed him to have the extra footage to facilitate him not having to do major demolition works, and in my view it's not our job to decide whether or not this man is going to be having to pay out to put right what he has done wrong. And so my feeling is that the original application was X, he hasn't complied with it, and that he should go back and do what he was asked to do in the first place.
Thank you, Gavin.
Through your chair, the building that was concerned now, to go with our consent, is a taller wing-view building. So in assessing the harm to the openness of the green belt and the visual impact of the building, its height particularly to the eaves and then its increased ridge, made it bulky and made it look more like a house, which is what the inspector picked up on in the enforcement of as well. So it wasn't so much the floor area, which in terms of what you see on site is fairly marginal and is something that we probably would have approved in the first place when we're looking at to rebuild. But it's the actual height and mass of the building. So this application brings that down. The eaves are actually slightly lower than the original approval, so that element of it has changed.
Thank you, Sheila. Ian?
Thanks, Chair. I heard all the comments from Les Spencer and from Bruce Berry about like saying we can't take into account the commission otherwise, but a person's suitability to be an applicant to put in planning commission otherwise, we may not end up applying very many. We go back to the point where we have previously looked at enforcement cases. Only on this occasion, we have the added weight of the planning inspector upholding the previous decision that we have made. And here we are, with the applicant having conducted pre-application discussions with the planning department and being told quite clearly what could and couldn't be applied for, and then building, in spite of those pre-application discussions, then applying for a retrospective planning permit, having that refused, appealing, having that appeal dismissed, and being told to go back to the original plan. And yet here we are now, with another application, for a building that is in effect 7 square metres bigger than what the planning application originally was approved for, and what the pre-application discussions were held almost four years ago. This is not a slip of an architect's pen, and somehow the builders got carried away. This, without listening to some of the comments about the applicant's character, you can see from the timeline on the application of what's happened, this is a deliberate attempt to build more than what was approved for. Now, I would say, whoever the applicant is, and you know, as a committee, we don't know the background of the applicants, we have to uphold what is done. And we have the added weight, in this case, of the planning inspectors saying that we were right. That doesn't happen very often. We've had applications where we have been appeals upheld, and we have had our original decisions overturned. On this occasion, we have clearly a planning inspector who has upheld our decision, and yet we get to the point now where we are discussing whether we go back on that original decision. I cannot see how, if we allow this tonight, any future application will not be at risk of going to the same process of appealing, losing the appeal, and then carrying on regardless. I think it's ridiculous, regardless of the background of the applicant, that we are in this position. The applicant has a decision notice. It's up to us to enforce it. The fact that it causes him problems is because he breached the original planning consents. That's not our problem.
Thank you, Ian. David?
Yeah, I have to say I concur with all that Ian Lewis has said. My concern really is that he's trying to sneak through an extra 7 metres planned on the QT and try and accept it on the ground that taking down the roof would still allow him to do that. I agree. I think we should go back to square one. We've got total support from the planning inspector in that all the decisions that we made previously were the correct ones. If we approve this one, all we're going to end up doing is approving a building that's 7 metres larger, and who knows, in a month's time, he'll probably put something else in which will be tried to sneak through in some way or other. I would like the officers just to confirm quite specifically, if we refuse this tonight, as has been suggested, we would go back to the status quo that the enforcement proceedings that have already been put in hand and were supported by the planning inspectors could immediately be invoked. I couldn't care less about how much it cost to remove this building. It's been built illegally, it's been built incorrectly, and it appears to be an attempt to circumvent our planning legislation. I find that absolutely appalling, and I find it that it would create a situation where there would be repeat types of this type of activity, which I'm not prepared to accept as a member of this planning committee. So the quick question is, if we refuse this tonight, do we then immediately start enforcement proceedings as per the arrangements that were made prior to this application being made? Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Chair. Yes, we could continue with the enforcement proceedings.
Okay, Stuart?
I agree with Cathy's comments. I've looked at the difference in the floor area. It strikes me as negligible. I have a listen to Councillor Gooseberry read from the inspector's letter, and then, you know, these guys, they choose their words with care. I'm trying to get the letter up on my mobile, but it won't load. But the extract that he read to us, the inspector made clear reference to the footprint. So it's clearly in their mind than just height. If it was just height they would consider, they would have said just height. But it sounds to me that the inspector also made reference to the footprint, and the increase in the footprint is clear, it's large, and the difference between the refused footprint and the footprint that we have in the current proposal